Dear Nintendo, hi, it's me, Austin, and I'm here to accomplish two very important things today. One, find out where all the starter Pokemon are, and two, finally make peace with all the Bulbasaur fans who are still mad that I omitted Bulbasaur from the list of Gen 1 starters when Matt and I deadlocked over a year ago by making this entire episode about Bulbasaur. Okay, well, that's technically not true because this episode is actually about all starter Pokemon, not just Bulbasaur, but almost all of them share the exact same mechanics when it comes to what I'm talking about today, from Gen 1 all the way to Gen... now. Okay, so they did slightly change in Ultra Sun and Ultra Moon, but only slightly and not in a way that really matters for this episode. So you can sub in any starters from any game and it will still be relevant today. But today, we're gonna use Bulbasaur because I'm a Gen 1-er and they're cute for a frog with a plant growing out of it. Anyway, as a Gen 1-er who has been playing since the original games were first released in the United States, I have been obsessed with finding out why starter Pokemon are so rare. I mean, like, in my head, I know it's because it's a game mechanic where they have to make the first Pokemon you get feel special to you and not make it any run-of-the-mill garbage rat you can find 10 minutes after stepping outside your front door, but that part in the Pokedex where it says Area Unknown haunted me. In a world filled with rumors of Mews being able to be caught behind the truck near the SS and a, what was it, the uncle of a friend of yours in school said if you could just get behind Bill's house, you could catch every rare Pokemon in the game and get infinite Eevees or something? Anyway, it was a young internet and none of us quite realized that anybody could write just about anything on game sages with little to no repercussions, and rumors about secret areas where you could find all the starters if you just completed the right steps remain chiseled into my brain for years after I stopped playing Pokemon regularly. Someday, I'd break into Bill's secret garden and find tall grass filled with Charmanders and Squirtles, and that Area Unknown entry in the Pokedex would finally disappear, and I'd get to have the ultimate answer to the rock, paper, scissors dilemma that Oak forces upon you within the very first minutes of the game. But alas, the rumors were just lies. Aside from some very specific exploits and hacks, once you pick your starter and your rival picks theirs, you will never run into any other Pokemon of that species again. That is, until the breeding mechanic was introduced in Generation 2. And it's here where the burning question in the back of my mind came rocketing back into my imagination. Starter Pokemon are, of course, breedable if you locate a Ditto, but what's more interesting is, with the breeding mechanics, Game Freak introduced an entirely new design component into their games that simultaneously raises more questions, but also itself begins to answer the question that has haunted me for over 20 years. Why are starter Pokemon so rare? Because they're going extinct. And how do I know this? Because of sex. I'm talking about biological sex here, not the act of sexual intercourse, even though that presumably has a role to play here, which I am not going to get into. Oops, I'm moving, but I said I wasn't going to get into it! Okay. For the sake of time, we're gonna skip over sexless Pokemon and say that in order to breed a Pokemon, you either need to have two Pokemon of the same species who are different sexes, or a Pokemon from the same egg group, whereupon the offspring from the breeding will be the species of the female Pokemon, or you need a Ditto who can morph into anything. Okay, got it? Good. Because of this, Pokemon need to have a sex assigned to them by the game. So when a Pokemon appears, the game just flips a coin to figure out whether it's male or female, right? Well, no. For the majority of Pokemon, approximately 56.24%, yes, this would be correct. Over a long enough timeline, most breedable Pokemon will have one female for every one male. This is what's known as a sex ratio. And for most animals and Pokemon, it is 1-to-1. It's hard to get exact numbers, but somewhere in the upper 90s of percents of animals on Earth have a sex ratio of 1-to-1, meaning for every male, there's one female. We will get into why that is in a bit, but what's important is that this is incredibly common, and what's more interesting is that starter Pokemon, they do not fall within this 56.24% of Pokemon with a 1-to-1 sex ratio. Starter Pokemon, all of them have a sex ratio of 7-to-1 males to females, meaning that for every one female Pokemon born, 7 males are born. And it turns out that this can have disastrous consequences to the population of a species. Before we get into explaining why having 0.1429 females born for every male can doom a species to extinction, I think we first have to go over why this 1-to-1 ratio is so freaking common in nature to begin with, even among populations where only a few males actually get to breed with a multitude of females, what's known as polygyny. Examples include gorillas, elephant seals, and high schools. And believe it or not, we do have an answer, and it boils down to a simple combination of mathematics and evolutionary science. So let's take a population of Bulbasaurs, and for the sake of argument, say that the sex ratio were reversed. 7 females per 1 male. That means that the average male Bulbasaur would get to mate 7 times more frequently than the average female. If each Bulbasaur has 1 egg, that means that the male's genes get passed down 7 times more than a female's genes would. All else being equal. But one of our Bulbasaurs got hit by space radiation and mutated, and now it produces more males than females. All of a sudden, the children of this one Bulbasaur would have a tremendous genetic edge in the population, having a bunch of dudes that can spread its genes, which means the male dominating gene would spread like wildfire until it got so prevalent that it was no longer an advantage and it was just the status quo. Now, all of a sudden, a mutation that produces more females than males gets an advantage and tips the scales the other way. And then this evolutionary trade-off goes back and forth and back and forth and back and forth, getting smaller and smaller each time until finally it settles at around a 1-to-1 ratio. This will almost always happen unless a skewed sex ratio provides a definite evolutionary advantage, like the adactylinium genus of mites that have boiled down efficient breeding to a hard, calculated science. I will spare you the details, but they have a ratio of 5-to-8 females per every male, and the Wikipedia page is, well, you can look it up for yourself. It is gross and awesome. So what does this have to do with Bulbasaur and the other starters? Well, quite a bit once you start to dig into the breeding mechanics. You see, one of the main issues with having a skewed sex ratio is that your species can become incredibly susceptible to changes in the ecosystem. Usually for a ratio other than 1-to-1 to stabilize, that means that a species is either relying on some weird behavioral quirk or some specific environmental factor that makes this method of procreation optimal. And when you're that dependent upon outside elements or precarious conditions to breed, sudden changes to your environment can sometimes happen too fast for evolution to have a chance to respond, and you just die out because nobody's making babies fast enough to replace the corpses that are piling up. Just ask the giant pandas, and you know who's great at causing massive changes to the environment? Humans. But I'm getting a little ahead of myself. In order to get a solid grasp over how Pokemon breeding would work in the wild, I created a simulation in Python that used all the well-documented breeding data of Pokemon to create fake populations for comparison. Pokemon are... well, the technical term is fecund. Every 255 to 257 steps, depending upon a generation, if you have Pokemon in the Pokemon daycare, the game runs a check versus a few different factors. And if they're met, it runs a probability check that an egg is laid, which can be anywhere from 20 to 88%. If an egg is laid, you can pick it up and your Pokemon can be immediately ready to lay another egg in 255 to 257 steps. Pokemon occurs in real time, given that it's tied to real-world day-night cycles, and each step takes about 0.2 seconds, meaning a fertile Pokemon will lay, on average, 840 viable eggs per day. Fecund! This 255 to 257 step period is something we're going to call a tick, and it's how I calculated all my fertility comparisons. Pokemon eggs hatch based on how many steps you take, too, and for 55% of Pokemon species, eggs hatch in 20 ticks. Got it? Good. So basically, I coded a math machine with probabilities and, importantly, a death rate. I pulled a death rate from another fecund animal species, the eastern cottontail rabbit, which has an average mortality rate of 80% over a year. I boiled this down to a number of ticks, since the average rabbit litter is 5 rabbits and Pokemon only lay 1 egg. This becomes an 80% mortality rate per 65 ticks. This is in the wild, mind you, and given the rate at which I murder Pokemon when grinding levels, that checks out. So, okay, I plugged all this into my code, which, I mean, okay, if you follow me on Twitter, I will link the GitHub when this video goes live, but you have to promise, okay? You promise not to mock me for the parts of my code that are not Pythonic, okay? Promise me! I'm sorry, okay? I was in a rush! I wanted to see if a species that had 7 males per every 1 female would be totally boned given they have litters of 1 egg at a time. Is this even viable if all things are perfect? Yes. Yes, it is, believe it or not. But the first inklings of weakness appeared really early on. In the very, very early stages, when populations were small, there was a slim but non-zero chance that all the females would die, and all the eggs that they managed to lay before they died would all hatch males, which would render a species extinction guaranteed if there were no dittos nearby. So the cracks are already starting to show. So, the population is viable. Great! And to cover my bases, I ran simulations on Rattatas and Litleos too. Rattatas have a 1-to-1 ratio, and Litleo is the only Pokemon species with a 7-to-1 female-to-male ratio. Okay, can I get those graphs to scale, though? Ha! That's better. I can barely see poor Bulbasaur down there, but that's fine. Nobody said they needed to be the most numerous species. Quality over quantity, right? However, how would our Bulbasaur population fare if we introduced anything, anything at all that impacted just the fertility rates? Not a new predator that's killing them more frequently, not less food, just something that disrupts their ability to breed as efficiently. Think of it as your parent knocking on your door during puberty. I built into my model a drop in fertility that occurs a little over a year into the growth of a population to see what happens. Here's the Litleo population. All right, seems good. Little hiccup here, but overall, everything is pretty good. Here's Rattatas. Oh, they don't even care. And now, our starter Pokemon population. Doing okay. Doing okay. Doing... Oh. Oh, no, no. Oh, no, 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 no! They're extinct! But why? Well, because there's so much risk concentrated into one sex, and it's the sex that creates eggs. The reason the reverse ratio has almost no problems at all is because if, like, a bunch of egg fertilizers die off and don't get to breed, it's not that big of a deal. There's still plenty of egg makers, and one egg fertilizer can, if he's prolific and has a high charisma score, fertilize every female in a species. In fact, Pokemon stacks the deck even further, because even if all the males of a species dies through some horrible bad luck, the species can still breed with a male from the same egg group. So the obliteration of a species really requires that all the females die, which is what makes this 1-to-7 female to male ratio so cataclysmically damning. If anything shows up that makes this delicate balance of food, resources, and mates no longer work, species with either more females than males or an equal number can easily take the punches in stride and work to adapt to the changing climate. It may be a struggle, but they will at least have one less thing to worry about when it comes to breeding. But species like Bulbasaur and the other starters, they are totally screwed. If something sudden happens that permanently alters the breeding conditions, like, I don't know, decreased grasslands for privacy, more spaced out breeding grounds, or increased lighting at night, their species will be long dead before a random mutation has time to show up and give them a chance to adapt to the new environment. And who is really, really good at dramatically and permanently altering environments in ways that impact local wildlife? humans. This isn't some hippy-dippy observation. This is just an objective, observable fact. Humans, as a body, are amazing at changing the world around them to suit their needs. Agriculture, diverting rivers, and yes, even lights at night can cause whole species to go extinct. There is a direct positive correlation between the human population and the number of species that go extinct. Even something as simple as electronic lighting can tremendously disrupt the behaviors of nocturnal animals by turning nighttime into daytime. And on evolutionary timelines, these advances are super new. Evolution can take thousands of years to adapt to new environments. And animals that rely on millions of years of predictability can be thrown for a loop when one human goes, hey, what if I invented the light bulb and 20 years later, bam, light everywhere. And now baby sea turtles are like, where do I go? I'm supposed to follow the moon, but the moon is literally everywhere. And just like real life, there are some species in the Pokemon universe that basically don't care and are barely impacted. And others, like Bulbasaur, they're practically nowhere to be found. The only examples we can find in-game are in captivity, which means even though they don't say it, what Professor Oak and the other Professor Trees are actually doing is conservation. They're trying to save a dying species from total annihilation, which, you know, seems like maybe handing them out to 10-year-olds maybe isn't the best idea, or maybe it is, I don't know. We can release a hell of a lot of Pokemon into the wild while we're grinding for shiny Pokemon with perfect IVs. So, what does this mean? It means that, well, Bulbasaur actually is special. It's one of the last of a handful of its species, a species of Pokemon that can now only survive in captivity. Even if you take the anime canon as true that there are breeding farms and preserves for starter Pokemon, this does not debunk this idea that starter Pokemon can only thrive under very controlled conditions and are one natural disaster away from total annihilation, all because of humanity. So, you know, cherish your starter Pokemon. They really are one of a kind. And, you know, find a Ditto and breed that thing like crazy, because just like the giant pandas in China, we desperately need these Pokemon to fuck. Sincerely, Austin.